Good afternoon, everybody. Just a quick announcement before we start. Could you just make sure we're all your mobile phones are either switched off or on silent? And anyone who's new to the cathedral facilities are down through the hallway there. And if there are any children need to go to the toilet, will you make sure an adult goes with them? Thanks. At Holy Communion, it's all down the centre. So stewards will guide you from the sides to come down the centre, and the same for veneration of the cross. And when the service starts, will you all kneel? And from now on, if we can just observe a period of silence. Thanks a lot.
Let us pray. Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection, sanctify your servants, for whom Christ your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the paschal mystery, who lives and reigns for ever and ever.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant will prosper. He shall be lifted up, exalted, rise to great heights. As the crowds were appalled on seeing him, so disfigured did he look that he seemed no longer human. So will the crowds be astonished at him, and kings stand speechless before him. For they shall see something never told, and witness something never heard before. Who could believe what we have heard, and to whom has the power of the Lord been revealed? Like a sapling, he grew up in front of us, like a root in arid ground. Without beauty, without majesty, we saw him. Nor looks to attract our eyes. A thing despised and rejected by men. A man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. A man to make people screen their faces. He was despised, and we took no account of him. And yet ours were the sufferings he bore, ours the sorrows he carried. But we thought of him as someone punished, struck by God, and brought low. Yet he was pierced through for our faults, crushed for our sins. On him lies a punishment that brings us peace, and through his wounds we are healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each taking his own way. And the Lord burdened him with the sins of all of us. Harshly dealt with, he bore it humbly. He never opened his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughterhouse, like a sheep that is dumb before its shearers, never opening its mouth. By force and by law he was taken. Would anyone plead his cause? Yes, he was torn away from the land of the living, for our faults struck down in death. They gave him a grave with the wicked, a tomb with the rich, though he had done no wrong, and there had been no perjury in his mouth. The Lord has been pleased to crush him with suffering. If he offers his life in atonement, he shall see his heirs. He shall have a long life, and through him what the Lord wishes will be done. His soul's anguish over, he shall see the light and be content. By his sufferings shall my servant justify many, taking their faults on himself. Hence I will grant whole hearts for his tribute. He shall divide the spoil with the mighty, for surrendering himself to death and letting himself be taken for a sinner, while he was bearing the faults of many, and praying all the time for sinners. The word of the Lord. A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Since in Jesus, the Son of God, we have the supreme high priest who has gone through to the highest heaven, we must never let go of the faith that we have professed. For it is not as if we had a high priest who was incapable of feeling our weaknesses with us, but we have one who has been tempted in every way that we are, though he is without sin. Let us be confident then in approaching the throne of grace, that we shall have mercy from him and find grace when we are in need of help. During his life on earth, he offered up prayer and entreaty, aloud and in silent tears, to the one who had the power to save him out of death. And he submitted so humbly that his prayer was heard. Although he was son, he learned to obey through suffering. But having been made perfect, he became for all who obey him the source of eternal salvation. The word of the Lord.
Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Jesus left with his disciples and crossed the Kedron Valley. There was a garden there, and he went into it with his disciples. Judas the traitor knew the place well, since Jesus had often met his disciples there, and he brought the cohort to this place together with a detachment of guards sent by the chief priests and the Pharisees, all with lanterns and torches and weapons. Knowing everything that was going to happen to him, Jesus came forward and said,
"Who are you looking for?"
Now Judas the traitor was standing among them. When Jesus said, "I am he moved back and fell to the ground. He asked them for a second time,
"Who are you looking for?"
"Jesus the Nazarene, Jesus the Nazarene, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus the Nazarene."
"I have told you that I am he. If I am the one you are looking for, let these others go."
This was to fulfill the words he had spoken. "Not one of those you gave me have I lost." Simon Peter, who carried a sword, drew it and wounded the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. And Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword back in its scabbard. Am I not to drink the cup that my Father has given me?"
The cohort and its captain and the Jewish guards seized Jesus and bound him. They took him first to Annas, because Annas was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had suggested to the Jews, "It is better for one man to die for the people." Simon Peter, with another disciple, followed Jesus. This disciple, who was known to the high priest, went with Jesus into the high priest's palace, but Peter stayed outside the door. So the other disciple, the one known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who was keeping the door, and brought Peter in. The maid at the door said to Peter,
"Aren't you another of that man's disciples?"
"I am not."
Now it was cold, and the servants and guards had lit a charcoal fire and were standing there warming themselves. So Peter stood there too, warming himself with the others. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. Jesus answered,
"I have spoken openly for all the world to hear. I have always taught in the synagogue and in the temple where all the Jews meet together. I have said nothing in secret. But why ask me? Ask my hearers what I taught. They know what I said."
At these words, one of the guards standing by Jesus gave him a slap in the face, saying,
"Is that the way to answer the high priest?"
"If there is something wrong in what I said, point it out. But if there is no offense in it, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him, still bound, to Caiaphas, the high priest. As Simon Peter stood there warming himself, someone said to him,
"Aren't you another of his disciples?"
"I am not."
One of the high priest's servants, a relation of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
"Didn't I see you in the garden with him?"
Again Peter denied it, and at once the cock crew. They then led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was now morning. They did not go into the praetorium themselves, or they would be defiled and unable to eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
What charge do you bring against this man?"
"If he were not a criminal, if he were not a criminal, then we should not be handing him over to you."
"Take him yourselves and try him by your own law."
"We are not about to put a man to death."
This was to fulfill the words Jesus had spoken, indicating the way he was going to die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and called Jesus to him and asked,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
"Do you ask this of your own accord, or have others spoken to you about me?" "Mine is not a kingdom of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my men would have fought to prevent me being surrendered to the Jews. But my kingdom is not of this kind."
"So you are a king then?"
"It is you who say it. Yes, I am a king. I was born for this. I came into the world for this, to bear witness to the truth. And all who are on the side of truth live."
listen to my voice.
And with that, Pilate went out again to the Jews and said,
I find no case against him, but according to a custom of yours, I should release one prisoner at the Passover. Would you like me then to release the king of the Jews?
No, not this man. No, not this man, but Barabbas, Barabbas, Barabbas.
Barabbas was a brigand. Pilate then had Jesus taken away and scourged. And after this, the soldiers twisted some thorns into a crown and put it on his head and dressed him in a purple robe. They kept on coming up to him and saying,
Hail, King of the Jews! Hail, King of the Jews! Hail,
and they slapped him in the face. Pilate came outside again and said to them,
Look, I am going to bring him out to you to let you see that I find no case.
Jesus then came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said, Pilate heard them say this, his fears increased. Re-entering the praetorium, he said to Jesus,
Where do you come from?
But Jesus made no answer.
Are you refusing to speak to me? Surely you know I have the power to release you, and I have the power to crucify you.
You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. That is why the one who handed you over to me has the greater guilt.
From that moment, Pilate was anxious to set him free, but the Jews shouted, Hearing these words, Pilate had Jesus brought out and seated himself on the chair of judgment at a place called the pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was Passover preparation day, about the sixth hour. Pilate said to the Jews, in the end, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified. They then took charge of Jesus, and carrying his own cross, he went out of the city to the place of the skull. or as it was called in Hebrew, Golgotha, where they crucified him with two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate wrote out a notice and had it fixed to the cross. It ran, "Jesus the Nazarene, King of the Jews." This notice was read by many of the Jews, because the place where Jesus was crucified was not far from the city. And the writing was in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the Jewish chief priest said to Pilate,
"You should not write, King of the Jews, but this man said, 'I am a king of the Jews.'"
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had finished crucifying Jesus, they took his clothing and divided it into four shares, one for each soldier. His undergarment was seamless, woven in one piece from neck to hem. So they said to one another,
"Instead of tearing it, let's throw dice to decide who is to have it."
In this way, the words of Scripture were fulfilled. "They shared out my clothing among them. They cast lots for my clothes." This is exactly what the soldiers did. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother, and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. Seeing his mother and the disciple he loved standing near her, Jesus said to her,
"Woman, this is your son."
Then to the disciple he said,
"This is your mother."
And from that moment, the disciple made a place for her in his home. After this, Jesus knew that everything had now been completed. And to fulfill the scriptures perfectly, he said,
"I am thirsty."
A jar full of vinegar stood there. So putting a sponge soaked in vinegar on a hyssop stick, they held it up to his mouth. After Jesus had taken the vinegar, he said,
"It is accomplished."
And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. It was preparation day, and to prevent the bodies remaining on the cross during the Sabbath, since that Sabbath was a day of special solemnity, the Jews asked Pilate to have their legs broken and the bodies taken away. Consequently, the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first man who had been crucified with him, and then the other. When they came to Jesus, they found that he was already dead. And so instead of breaking his legs, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a lance, and immediately there came out blood and water. This is the evidence of one who saw it, trustworthy evidence, and he knows he speaks the truth. And he gives it so that you may believe as well, because all this happened to fulfill the words of Scripture. "Not one bone of his will be broken." And again, in another place, Scripture says, "They will look on the one whom they have pierced." After this, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because he was afraid of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him remove the body of Jesus. Pilate gave permission, so they came and took it away. Nicodemus came as well, the same one who had first come to Jesus at night. And he brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, following the Jewish burial custom. At the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had yet been buried. Since it was the Jewish day of preparation, the tomb was near at hand, and they laid Jesus there.
Although it's an instrument of torture and death, there is something fascinating about the cross of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the Redeemer of the world, by whose cross and resurrection we are set free. Somehow we're drawn to it. No matter who we are, no matter where we come from or find ourselves, we know that we can come to the cross without judgment. We can drag all the clutter of our lives with us and leave it there at the foot of the cross. We can pour out all the sorrows and despair in our lives and leave it there. We can bring all the hypocrisy, all the duplicity, all the hatred, all the jealousy in our hearts, and we can leave it all at the cross. In my life as a priest and bishop, I've celebrated this afternoon's liturgy in all sorts of places, different countries, different parishes, different dioceses. I've been privileged to have a special position in that I can watch all those who come to venerate the cross. And I never cease to wonder at the powerful attraction of the cross that I witness every single year. Young and old, strong and weak, people of sound faith and people whose faith is perhaps a little bit shaky, those trying to live a good life, those who know that their life is far from good, all coming in procession to venerate the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Redeemer of the world. So let nothing hold you back. There's no barrier, there's no obstacle, save for the pride of our own hearts. We adore you, cross. We adore your cross, O Lord. We praise and glorify your holy resurrection. For behold, because of the wood of the tree, joy has come to the world. Lord Jesus, help us to see in your cross all the crosses of the world, the cross of people hungry for bread and for love, the cross of people alone and abandoned even by their children and kin, the cross of people thirsty for justice and for peace, the cross of people who lack the comfort of faith, the cross of the elderly who struggle under the weight of years and of loneliness, the cross of migrants who find doors closed in fear and hearts armored by political calculations, the cross of little ones wounded in their innocence and their purity, the cross of humanity that wanders in the darkness of uncertainty and in the obscurity of temporary culture, the cross of families split by betrayal, by the seduction of the evil one, or by homicidal levity and selfishness, the cross of consecrated people who tirelessly seek to bring your light into the world and feel rejected and derided and humiliated, the cross of consecrated people who along the way have forgotten their first love, the cross of your children who, while believing in you and seeking to live according to your word, find themselves marginalized and rejected even by their families and their peers. The cross of our weaknesses, of our hypocrisy, of our betrayal, of our sins and of our many broken promises. The cross of your church, that faithful to your gospel, struggles to spread your love even among the baptized themselves. The cross of the church, your bride, that feels constantly assailed from within and without. The cross of our common home that is gravely withering before our selfish eyes, blinded by greed and by power. Lord Jesus, revive in us the hope of resurrection and of your definitive victory over all evil and all death. Amen. We're now going to have the general intercession, so if you'd like to kneel or sit as you prefer.
For Holy Church, let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world. And grant that, leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God, the Father Almighty.
Almighty, ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church, spread throughout all the world, may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. For the Pope, let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church, to govern the holy people of God.
Almighty, ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favour on our prayers, and in your kindness, protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you, their Maker, may glory in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. For all orders and degrees of the faithful, let us pray also for our Bishop Terence Patrick, for all bishops, priests and deacons of the Church, and for the whole of the faithful people.
Almighty, ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace all may serve you faithfully, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. For catechumens, let us pray also for catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts, and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness of all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus, our Lord.
Almighty, ever-living God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. For the unity of Christians, let us pray also for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth, to gather them together and keep them in his one church.
Almighty, ever-living God, who gather what is scattered, and keep together what you have gathered. Look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. For the Jewish people, let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant.
Almighty ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen. For those who do not believe in Christ, let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation.
Almighty ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. For those who do not believe in God, let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God himself.
Almighty ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you and by finding you come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of all the human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. For those in public office, let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to his will, for the true peace and freedom of all.
Almighty ever-living God, in whose hands lie every human heart and the rights of peoples, look with favour, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace and freedom of religion may through your gift be made secure, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. For those in tribulation, let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that he may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying.
Almighty ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice because in their hour of need your mercy was at hand, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The cross is going to be brought down the aisle for us to worship and adore. The deacon will stop at the back of the church if we all turn round and face the cross, and then genuflect when we've sung the little versicle. And then the deacon moves to the middle, we stand up, face the cross again, kneel down, and then finally the cross comes to the front of the church, and once more we stand up and then genuflect before the cross. When we come to the veneration of the cross, whatever you feel comfortable to do to venerate the cross, please feel free, either bowing touching or kissing the cross. The altar servers will sanitize the cross each time if somebody kisses it. So feel, whichever way you feel comfortable to venerate the cross, please do so. We stand there.
Let us adore.
Let us stand, and as the Saviour, at the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
If you'd like to kneel down, please. This evening, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, not bring me to judgment and condemnation, but through your loving mercy be for me protection in mind and body and a healing remedy. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Bow down for the blessing.
May abundant blessings, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people, who have honoured the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.